baptize me with the Holy Ghost. Like a raging fire burning my soul. Baptize me with the Holy Ghost. Like a raging fire burning my soul. Baptize me with the Holy Ghost. Like a raging fire burning my soul. Baptize me with the Holy Ghost. Like a raging fire burning my soul. Baptize me with the Holy Ghost. Like a raging fire burning my soul. Baptize me with the Holy Ghost. Like a raging fire burning my soul. Baptize me with the Holy Ghost. Like a raging fire burning my soul. Baptize me with the Holy Ghost. Like a raging fire burning my soul. Baptize me with the Holy Ghost. Like a raging fire burning my soul. Baptize me with the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah! Bible says that the Antichrist has come to wear out the saints of the Most God. But God gave us a picture of that. He said that the devil cometh but not for to steal, kill, and destroy. And if you live for God long enough, the enemy is going to step in, and he is going to try to steal your walk with God. And then he's going to step a step further, and he's going to try to kill your walk with God. But I want to tell you something. That verse does not stop there. But God said, Jesus said, but I have come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly. You know what? The enemy does not have the last say-so. You know, there's times you walk in your life, you may have to face that Goliath spirit that David fought. You may have to. There may be a heat of battle that you go into that you may not know how you're going to get through it, but you're going to have to face it. Or you may end up having to face that spirit that Daniel had to face in the lion's den. You know, and there are even times that you may have to face the fiery furnace that the three Hebrew children had to walk through. But be this known unto you that God is there. He said that I have come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly. I don't care what spirit is attaching itself to you or trying to attach itself to you. The outcome is that you will have life and life more abundantly. I don't care what's going on in your life today. If you lift your hands toward heaven today and you start proclaiming the mercies of God in your life, hey, that spirit's got to leave. It's got to go. It cannot stay. It cannot stay. We are victorious today. We are victorious. The Bible said that the children come out of Egypt with a high hand. We are coming out with a high hand. I don't care what your situation is. You can come out of this with a high hand. We're going to sing this one more time today. And if there is something that is trying to stifle you, is trying to pull you down today, you have the authority today in the name of Jesus to pull that stronghold down today by proclaiming the love and the mercy of God in your life. Go ahead and sing this one more time. And I want you to start thinking about something that God has brought you through. And if he's done it one time, he'll do it twice for you. Go ahead, praise the Lord and see what he'll do for you. We're going to stay in this till the end. And you know what? Then we're going to go meet the Lord Jesus Christ. And we're going to receive our inheritance. Hallelujah. The promise is if we stay in this. We don't, you know, it ain't how many times we fall, but it's how many times we get up. Hallelujah. If we get up more times than we fall, then we're going to make it. We're going to make it. Praise the Lord. Thank you. Thank you for the spirit that we feel in here today, Lord Jesus. Hey, don't you feel him here today? Don't you feel him here today? Praise the Lord. Won't you be making your way back to your seats, and the ushers be helping us, getting ready to receive our Sunday morning offering. What a powerful presence of the Holy Ghost in here today. What a powerful presence of the Holy Ghost here today. Do you believe that? That same spirit that was on the day of Pentecost is here today. And if you don't know it, if you don't know what I'm talking about, you can experience it today in the fullness of its power. If I got any witnesses here today, what spirit am I talking about? I'm talking about the Spirit of God living inside of us. Jesus said, or they said, that you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Power to do what? Power to overcome our corrupt human nature. Power to walk right. Power to talk right in a terrible, evil world. We have the power of Christ within us to do the right things, to stay on the right course. Praise God. I'm thankful for that spirit today. We're going to go ahead. We got a few requests we'd like to make known before the Lord before we receive our offering today. Sister Janet Connor is sick today. Also, we have a few people in the hospital. And if I miss somebody, please forgive me. We're going to pray anyway over everyone. So if I miss a name, don't shoot me. So I'm just, Brother Ezra Butler is in the ICU today. We know you know his situation. And Sister Mamie Rhodes, I believe, broke her hip as well. And Brother J.J. Jameson is in the hospital. And Sister Della Rose as well. And there may be other needs across here. Like I said, if you have loved ones in the hospital, our prayers are with you right now, with them as well. And across this church house, I'm pretty sure that you may have a need or two. If you'd like to make that known by the uplift of your hand this morning, God knows exactly what your need is without you even mentioning it. That's the kind of God we serve today. He is moved by our needs today. We're going to pray. We're going to ask the Lord to help us today. Father, we love you. Thankful, God, to be able to come to you in prayer, God, to call on your name. God, and we know that there's power in your name. That when we begin to call on your name, God, that all the devils in hell have to tremble. God, that spirit of infirmity has to leave. That you bore stripes for our healing, God. God, and it's your will today, God, that you would touch your people, God. That you would touch these unable bodies that's in the hospital today, God. That you'll guide these doctors' hands, God, today. And I pray, God, that you would also move upon your people today, God. You know the people that's here today that's suffering from ailment. They may be suffering from situations in their mind that they cannot get a hold of today, God. We take authority over that by the name of Jesus Christ today. And I declare freedom in this place today. I declare healing in this place today. In the name of Jesus, we declare it in Jesus' name. God, we pray today, God, that you would also anoint everyone that gives today and bless this offering to the edification of the church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you will, why don't you let the ushers lead you today and bring your offering and give as unto the Lord. Praise today.
What a great, mighty God we serve. That's right. Go ahead and worship the Lord today. Oh, if you got the Holy Ghost, give Him praise today. If you want the Holy Ghost, give Him praise today. Hallelujah, Lord. We love You, Jesus. That's right. Go ahead and worship the Lord. God's already doing great things. Amen. God bless you. You can be seated for a few moments. We'll be standing again in just a moment as we get into the Word of the Lord today. But it's certainly good to see all of you in the house of the Lord. And it's a pleasure to have all of our guests with us. Can you let our guests know how much that we're thankful that they're at Bethlehem today? Thank you for coming. And we're honored that you're here and excited about what the Lord is doing. Looking forward to the blessings of the Lord and excited about what God is going to do. We had two of our church staff members that had birthdays this week. Brother Ethan had his birthday yesterday, and happy birthday to Brother Ethan. I'm not going to sing happy birthday to anybody. That would nullify the happy part. Sister Joanna Murphy turned 39 again today, and we're amen. Happy birthday to Sister Joanna. And we've had other folks in the church that had birthdays, but I want to let our staff members know how much we appreciate them and their hard work and what they do for the kingdom of God. And I had been scheduled. Our Starkville church had their one-year anniversary this weekend. It's the 1 year that Starkville has been in existence, and God is doing a great work there. And we're in the process of making them a standalone congregation, their own bylaws, their own everything. And the church is doing so well. And I had already committed to be there yesterday. And I wanted to tell Sister Joanna happy birthday, but I was afraid I'd let the cat out of the bag about her surprise party. She might have already figured it out. She figures just about everything out. But I didn't let it out. And so if you have a surprise party coming up, I'm going to try my best to keep it a secret. But happy birthday to our staff members today. Amen. You've heard the prayer requests for Brother Ezra Butler. And the doctors say that he has pneumonia and God needs to heal him. So that's how I want you to pray, is that God would heal him of his pneumonia and strengthen him. And if it looks like, if they can get that taken care of, that everything else is doing all right. So we need to pray that God take care of that pneumonia in Jesus' name. Sister Mamie, again, is in need of prayer. You heard that request. She broke her hip, and she just needs prayer. She needs prayer. Right now, I think the hip may be the least of the reasons we need to pray for. But be in prayer for Sister Mamie. The Lord help her in her recovery and just touch her and be with her. And Sister Della Rose, and she is in need of prayer, that the Lord would touch her in a special way. And Brother J.J. Jameson had a blockage in his carotid artery. They were able to go in and take care of that. They did not get him back to his room from the operating room until midnight that night. The doctor said it was the worst situation he had ever seen, trying to get that taken care of. But thank the Lord they were able to. I was able to see him. And my point is, we have a lot of our elders that are really in need of prayer today. And if you'll continue to do that, it will definitely be appreciated. 5 o'clock. Everybody say 5 o'clock. 5 o'clock today. All of our platform, music, team, singers, choir, etc. Please meet me here at 5 o'clock. And we're going to get together for a few minutes. And next Sunday night, everybody say next Sunday. Next Sunday night. Next Sunday night, our Starkville church, those that can come, are going to be here. Brother Martinez and his group from up at South Haven are going to be here. And we're going to have a service. And I would like for you to do all you can to be here. And let's let the Holy Ghost work. There's some folks in Starkville that need the Holy Ghost. And are coming, and Brother Brandon's praying and believing God they're going to get it while they're here. And I want to just have Holy Ghost Church next Sunday night. And let's just let the Lord do a great work. That's the 17th next Sunday night. Amen. Amen. On the 18th, on Monday night, Kineo Resources meeting. All of our leaders, that's at 7 o'clock on Monday. But I might mention that anybody in the church that would like to come to that, you will be blessed. You'll be excited, and you'll enjoy it. That's at 7 o'clock Monday the 18th. On the 23rd, Saturday morning, we have an evangelism workshop, and we're looking forward to that. Brother Adam Hunley is going to be here. The pastor in Oman, in Muscat, Oman, and he's going to be here, and we're going to have an evangelism workshop Saturday morning, the 23rd. I know we got some folks from Starkville coming up, some folks from South Haven and maybe some other areas, but we want to do our part to win the world that we live in. So that's Saturday, the 23rd. On Sunday, the 24th, Brother Jonathan Atkins is going to be here. And he is a great preacher, and God has blessed his ministry with great, mighty revival everywhere that he's going. And that is on the 24th, Sunday morning, Sunday night, and the 27th on Wednesday night. Now, again, I've mentioned it before, we don't add a lot of extra nights. We don't have revivals, we don't add a lot of extra nights, because I know how far you come to church, some of you, and I know how far that some of you go to work every day. So we don't add a lot of extra nights. So when we have something special, I hope that you'll go out of your way. Since I go out of my way to try not to overschedule you on off nights, I hope you'll go out of your way to be here on the 24th and 27th. Brother Atkins will be here. Amen. We're in our month of prayer and fasting. And however you're doing that, I hope that you are committing yourself to it and believing God. And let's pray and believe God for a great move of the Holy Ghost in this place. Amen. Amen. There is a missing Bible. There's a missing Bible that belongs to, it's inscribed to either Randy or Randall Baldwin. And a guest that came with Brother DJ and his family left it here accidentally. It has some family pictures inside of it. It is a black Bible. So if there is a Bible that's near to you, and a black Bible that you know doesn't belong to you, and it has Randall or Randy Baldwin in it, please make sure that we get that so we can get that back to them. And it's a very important thing to this family. If you'll stand with me and turn in the Bible to the book of Acts, chapter number 2. The book of Acts, chapter number 2. And I got a whole lot of scriptures this morning, and I've got my eye on the clock here. And I want to talk to you about the Holy Ghost this morning. And the book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse 36, 37, and 38, 39. And our projection is, we had a part that we need to order for the system. And that part came in yesterday. We're hoping to get it put in this afternoon. If we could get a couple of volunteers after service to come and help, we can have that up and running tonight. I wish we had it now, but that's the way that technology is. You know, just we're just at the mercy of technology, and sometimes it works and sometimes it don't. And when it does, great, and when it doesn't, I hope you brought your Bibles. Sister Pam scared the fire out of me Wednesday night. She scared me till I was almost in that great cloud of witnesses waiting on y'all to get there. I was down in the dining room getting ready for our Wednesday night class, and she's part ninja, because she snuck up behind me, and there was nothing subtle about it. There was not any, "Hey, Brother V," it was, "Thank you for reminding me to bring my Bible." And I was like, "Dear God, I'm going to heaven right now." But you're welcome. So, amen. We almost had my funeral this week. It would not be a bad idea if you're coming up just to say, "Hey, Brother V," from a distance. That's just for future reference for anybody and everybody. This morning I'm going to preach to you about the Holy Ghost. The Bible talks about the Holy Ghost. It talks about the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of God, and the Holy Spirit. But all those terms refer to the same thing. The Holy Ghost is the Spirit of Jesus Christ. It's not a third person. It is the Spirit of Jesus Christ, the Comforter.
The book of Acts chapter number 2 and verse 36. Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Everybody say that with me. What shall we do? Tell us what we need to do. The Spirit, the Lord, touched their heart. And when the Lord touched their heart, the question was, tell us what we got to do. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Praise God. Oh, hallelujah. For the promise, everybody say the promise. For the promise is unto you. Point at somebody and tell them that's your promise. Point at yourself and tell, say, it's my promise. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. If you are called by God, you have a promise of the Holy Ghost. Amen. I'm glad I got it. There's something about the power of the Holy Ghost. I can't explain it, but I got it, and I'm glad I got it. It's the greatest thing that's ever happened in my life. I'm so glad I'm in an apostolic church where we still preach and teach the apostles' doctrine. Repentance, water baptism in Jesus' name, and the great gift of the Holy Ghost. I'm glad I've got it. Give God praise if you have it. Give God praise if you want it. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. God bless you. You can be seated. Thank you for standing. I'm glad that the Holy Ghost is a promise. I'm glad God promised it to me. In the book of Joel, the prophet Joel, chapter 2 and verse number 28, the prophet of God said, it shall come to pass afterward. Now look, I got all these on projection. We just don't have projection. So you have to follow along. You have to follow quick. You have to listen to me. It said, it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Amen. God is pouring His Spirit out on everybody. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. Matthew 3:11, Jesus, or John the Baptist rather, said, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me. Aren't you glad there's somebody that came after John the Baptist? I'm glad that there's more than just the baptism of repentance. But he said, he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. For he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Let me just tell the church, I still believe that if you got the Holy Ghost, there's some fire to it. I don't believe a Holy Ghost church ought to be dead church. I don't believe a Holy Ghost church ought to be a dead, dry church. I believe there ought to be fire that comes when the Holy Ghost falls. If you're in a place where you can talk in tongues, there ought to be a fire of joy that comes from your soul. If you got the Holy Ghost, you ought to say, God, baptize me with the fire one more time. Oh, I'm starting to feel the fire of the Spirit in this place. Hallelujah. I'm glad we don't just have the Holy Ghost, but we got fire. There's something to be excited about when you got the Holy Ghost. Brother Barry, you talked about the Holy Ghost. When you got the Holy Ghost, there's a reason to be excited. Hey, it's better than any sports team. It's better than any drug high. It's better than anything this world has to offer. It's the Holy Ghost and fire. And I've got it. I said, I've got it. And it's got me. It's the best thing that's ever happened in my life. Praise God. Joel prophesied and promised the Holy Ghost was coming. John the Baptist prophesied and said the Holy Ghost was coming. And then in John chapter number 7, Jesus stepped up and he prophesied. He said, he that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Amen. If you believe on him like the Bible says, there will be a flow of living water. What is this living water? What is he talking about? What's Jesus trying to say? And the next verse said, verse 39, this spake he of the Spirit. Jesus prophesied that if you believe on me like the Bible said, that the Spirit is going to flow out of you like living water. This spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. That word should. I heard somebody say, well, it says I should get it, but it doesn't say I have to get it. The Greek word for the word should means it's necessity. It is purpose. It is your duty. He that believeth on him like the scripture hath said. And he said, this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him have the necessity to receive. Amen. If believing alone is enough. I've heard people say, well, I got the Holy Ghost when I believe. That's not what Jesus said. Jesus said, if you believe, that you should receive it, that it's necessary to get it. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given because Jesus was not yet glorified. Amen. If this was an all-day Bible school class, I would just go ahead and I would say that proves right there that the Holy Ghost is not a third person. The Holy Ghost is the Spirit of Jesus Christ, because the Holy Ghost couldn't be given until Jesus was glorified, because Jesus is God and the Holy Ghost is the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'll move on. John chapter 14 and verse number 26. It said, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost. Everybody say, the Holy Ghost is the Comforter. The Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost. The Comforter is the Holy Ghost. Amen. The Comforter is the Holy Ghost. John 14 and 17 and 18. Even the Spirit of truth, who the world cannot receive. Now, the Bible said in John, it said the Comforter is the Holy Ghost. And then the Bible called it the Spirit of truth. What did Jesus say he was? I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. The Bible said that the Holy Ghost is the Spirit of truth. If it's the Spirit of truth, and Jesus is the truth, the Holy Ghost is the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but you know him, for he dwelleth with you. This was in the gospel. Jesus was talking. He said he dwelleth with you. He was walking with them. He was eating with them. He was talking with them. He was praying for them. He was preaching to them. He said, right now he dwells with you, but there's going to come a day, he said, and he shall be in you. Amen. I'm glad that the Holy Ghost isn't only with me, but he's in me. Praise God. The Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost. John 14, 26. John 14, 18. Jesus said, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. The Comforter. He said, I'm not going to leave you without a Comforter. I'm going to come to you. And then 14 and 26, he said, the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, because the Holy Ghost is the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Amen. Praise God. I'll move. The gospel, the book of Acts, chapter number 1, verses 4 and 5. And being assembled together with them, commanded them. This is Jesus after he was resurrected out of the tomb and before he ascended into heaven. He assembled the people together and commanded them. Everybody say it was a command. Commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise. The promise. It's the promise. Joel promised it. John the Baptist promised it. Jesus promised it. And in Acts he said, you wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. Amen. It was prophesied. It was promised. I'm telling you, the Holy Ghost is your promise. You have a promise from the Word of God. You have a promise that you can receive the Holy Ghost. Amen. He went on in Acts 1 and 8. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Listen, I've heard people say, I can't live for God. If you get the Holy Ghost, you can live for God. Amen. Because when you get the Holy Ghost, you get power that comes with it. The power of the Holy Ghost. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. If you're weak and don't feel like you can make it, God, baptize me with the Holy Ghost. Get me the power that I need to make it. And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, all Judea, Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the world. When God makes a promise, God keeps his promises. Acts chapter number 2, verses 1 through 4. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Oh God, I wish I had time to preach what happens when everybody in the place gets in one accord. Do you know what would happen if everybody in this place made up their mind that we wanted a Holy Ghost revival? If we really decided that we wanted a Holy Ghost outpouring of the Holy Ghost, if we really made up our mind, God, I want a baptism of your Spirit in this place, when everybody in the place gets in one accord. The Bible said, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven. Oh, Lord. I don't know which one. The Bible said there was 120 in that upper room. And I don't know how long it took time for them to pray and get in one accord. I'd like to think that maybe when it started, the 12 apostles knew what he wanted to do, and they were in one accord. And it wasn't long till Mary, the mother of Jesus, who was in the room, started thinking, hey, I believe what they're saying. And then below, after a while, his brothers got to praying with them. And before long, the group of believers that were in that upper room began, yeah, I believe we want an outpouring of the Holy Ghost. And one by one, they began to get in one accord. I don't know who number 120 was. But whoever number 120 was, they were all waiting on him or her. They were all waiting on that person to get their mind in tune for revival. I don't know who in this place, maybe the ones that hadn't decided you want an outpouring of the Holy Ghost, but when you make up your mind, there's going to come a suddenly outpouring of the Spirit of revival on this church and on your family. Amen. When that last person got in one accord, the Bible said, and suddenly. They had been there for days and it hadn't happened. But when everybody made up their mind, we want it, suddenly it happened. I preached revival for years to this church. I preached apostolic revival for years. And I don't know when it's going to happen, but when the last people make up their mind, I want to have it, that's when it's going to suddenly be poured out. God, let it be today. I wish it was today. I wish it was today that somebody would say, yeah, I want to be a part of that great end time revival. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. Everybody say it sounds like wind. Everybody shout it sounds like wind. And it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire. Everybody say it's like fire. It's wind and fire. And it sat upon each of them and they were all filled. Everybody say all. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. I've had people say, well, do I need the Holy Ghost? Well, we'll answer that in a minute, but let me tell you, that shouldn't be the first question. The first question shouldn't be, do I need the Holy Ghost? The first question should be, can I get the Holy Ghost? I've never had my kids come to me and say, Daddy, do we have to have Christmas? Anybody have kids that ever came to them and say, do we have to have Christmas? Do we really have to have all these gifts? Do we really have to do this? That the question is not, do we have to have Christmas? It's always, how much longer till Christmas? When can we have Christmas? We are in Indiana for Christmas on Christmas Day, and we do our family Christmas here usually on New Year's Day morning. But this year we did it on New Year's Eve morning. But But all through that week, from the time we got back, we got home on the Saturday after Christmas, from the minute we got in that vehicle, it seemed like all the way home and that entire week, when can we do Christmas? When do we get to have Christmas? When do we get to open our presents? And that whole week in between, there's that Christmas tree. Don't get me started on that. I'm a bit of a Scrooge when it comes to some stuff. And there's all those gifts underneath of it. And there's all that stuff. And here's these two kids. They've already had Christmas at their grandmother, at their grandparents' house. And then my side of the family, we had Christmas. They've already had two of them. And you'd think they didn't get anything there. And all week long, when do we get to have Christmas? When do we get to have Christmas? When do we get to open these gifts? When do we get to open all presents? When do we get to do this? Daddy, can we open all presents today? Why do we have to wait? When can we? It's never do we have to do it. It's always when can we do it. If you're asking, do I have to have the Holy Ghost? You're asking the wrong question. It's God, when can I get the Holy Ghost? When can I have the Holy Ghost? It's so good, it shouldn't be a matter of have to. Everybody ought to want it. The Holy Ghost is so good, everybody ought to say, God, pour it out. God, give it to me. I don't have to have it. I want the Holy Ghost. Praise God. Luke 11 and 13, if ye then being evil, everybody say, I'm evil. Not I'm evil, point at yourself and say it. If ye then being evil, we all got weaknesses. We all have faults. We all have personality flaws. We all have things that we shouldn't do. If ye then being evil know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? You ought to want it, because if you can give a good gift to your kid with all of your faults and failures, with all of your weaknesses, with all of the frailties of your humanity, and you still can give good gifts to your kid, how much better is it when a God that is perfect and upright in all of his ways, how much better can your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? The Holy Ghost is the greatest gift you can ever give, given by the greatest Father you could ever have. Amen. There's never been a gift given like the Holy Ghost. There's never been a... I've had people say, I got exactly what I wanted. I heard somebody say yesterday at the church in Starkville that a little girl was telling Brother and Sister Frazier all the stuff that she wanted for Christmas, all the things that she wanted. And then when after Christmas she saw him again, and she climbed up in Sister Frazier's lap and she said, I got everything I wanted. I'm going to tell you, when I got the Holy Ghost, I got everything I wanted, because my Heavenly Father gives good gifts, and the Holy Ghost is the best gift. That's why it's called the gift of the Holy Ghost. It's the greatest gift from the greatest Father. Amen. I said it's the greatest gift from the greatest Father. Brother Robert, I watch you back there when the Holy Ghost gets on you and you start talking in tongues. It's the greatest gift from the greatest Father. I remember the day you got the Holy Ghost. You talk about the power of God, the glory of God. It's the greatest gift from the greatest Father. If you're saying, do I have to have the Holy Ghost, you're asking the wrong question. Romans 8 and 9, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. How do I get in the Spirit? Tell me how I'm not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. Tell me how that happens. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. You can only get in the Spirit if the Spirit's in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Look, I wish I had some positive thinking. I wish I had some positive cliche that I could just throw out and make everybody feel like everybody's all right. I know the modern thinking is all roads lead to the same place, and everybody has truth, and all religions are the same, and there's no difference between this and that. But that's not what the Bible said. The Bible said, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. That's not my word. That's God's word. That's not Bethlehem Church's word. That's God's word. That's the Bible. You're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. The only way you can get in the Spirit is if the Spirit of God is in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Adam Clark said, he doesn't belong to the kingdom. Albert Barnes said, it's none of his. John Wesley said, it's not in the state of salvation. He said, it's a plain express declaration which admits of no exception. The Bible said, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. Romans 8 and 11, two verses later. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you. Everybody say if. Come on, say if. If the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you. Everybody say in. If it's in you. He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. When the rapture happens, when the Lord comes back for his church, the Bible said the dead in Christ are going to rise first, and those of us which are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. But the only way that happens is if we're full of the Holy Ghost, because it's the Spirit. It's the Spirit that's going to quicken our mortal bodies. If I'm not full of the Holy Ghost, when the rapture happens, that Spirit's not going to quicken me. Because it takes the Spirit to be quickened. I'm preaching good Bible doctrine here. I know I'm not preaching financial blessing and healing, but this is soul healing today. If the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead, you got to have the Spirit in you. If it dwell in you, he that raised Christ from the dead will also quicken your mortal bodies. You got to have the Holy Ghost to go in the rapture. That's Bible. 1 Corinthians 12 and 3. Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed. And that no man can say no man. No man can say that Jesus is the Lord, but by the Holy Ghost. No man can say that Jesus is the Lord, the Master, my Master, but by the Holy Ghost. 1 Corinthians 12 and 13. For by one Spirit, everybody say one Spirit. Are we baptized into one body? Whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, we have been made to drink into one Spirit. There's one Spirit that puts us in the church. You can be from anywhere in the world. You can be a Jew, a Gentile. You can be a slave, a free man. You can be rich or poor, educated, uneducated, red and yellow, black and white. Doesn't matter any of that. The only thing that matters that gets you in the church is, are you full of the Holy Ghost? Because it's by the Spirit that we're baptized into the body. We don't join the body. We don't sign up for the body. We don't take the right hand of fellowship to get in the body. By one Spirit, we are baptized into the body. Amen. John 20 and 22. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. This is Jesus after the crucifixion and the resurrection, but before the ascension, he breathed on them and he said, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Jesus told his followers to get the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you, in this place today, Jesus is telling you, get the Holy Ghost, get the Holy Ghost, get the Holy Ghost. He wants you to receive the Holy Ghost. It's your promise. He wants you full of the Holy Ghost. He wants you baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. If you've had it before and you need it again, he wants you to get it again. He wants us all full of the Holy Ghost. John 3 and 5, Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Whew. Except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit. We believe in water baptism in Jesus' name. And we believe in Spirit baptism, speaking in other tongues. And except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit. See, there's got to be a spiritual birth that happens. There's got to be a spiritual birth that happens. You got to be born of the Spirit. And if you're not born of the Spirit, the Bible said, I didn't say it, the Bible said, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. The Holy Ghost, if the Holy Ghost is a promise, and it is, and if we need the Holy Ghost, and we do, how do I know if I got the Holy Ghost? John 3 and 8, the wind bloweth where it listeth. and thou hearest the sound thereof. He said, the wind blows where it wants to blow, where it listeth. The wind goes where it wants to go. And you hear the sound thereof. Anybody ever hear the sound of the wind? Anybody ever hear the wind howling before? You don't know where it's coming from or where it's going. You don't know how it got there, but you just know it's there, and you can hear the sound thereof. The wind blows where it listeth. Remember what it was in Acts chapter number 2? The Holy Ghost. Remember what it was like? A rushing. I had you say it when we did the verse for a reason. A rushing, mighty wind. John said, the wind bloweth where it listeth. It goes where it wants to go. I can't tell the Holy Ghost who to fill. I can't tell I don't believe in jabbing people's mouth when they get the Holy Ghost. I don't believe in shaking their jaw. I don't think God needs my thumb and finger to make somebody talk in tongues. I don't believe in that. I don't believe in shaking them. You know, we one time, you get somebody on one side, they say, hold on. You get somebody on the other side saying, let go. You get somebody over here saying, give in. And you got somebody over here saying, don't give up. No wonder people are confused. But I don't think I need to be going, come on, I'll help you, God. I'll help you, God. Uh-uh. The Bible said the wind bloweth where it listeth. I can't tell God who to give the Holy Ghost to. I can't make people get the Holy Ghost. There's no magic powder that you can throw on somebody and they get the Holy Ghost. The wind goes where it wants to. But I tell you that you can hear the sound of the wind. You can't tell where it comes or where it goes. And listen to this. The last phrase of John 3:8. So is everyone. Anybody got their Bible open to John 3:8? What's the last phrase say?
So is everyone that is born.
Everyone. Anybody else got their Bible open to John 3:8? What's it say? Everyone. Everyone. He said, so is everyone that is born of the Spirit. It's an analogy. He's using the wind to teach a lesson. He said, here's what you know about the wind. It goes where it wants to. You don't know where it comes from or where it goes. But you know it's there because you can hear the sound thereof. And he said, that's the same way it is. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Everybody that's born of the Spirit. You can't see the Holy Ghost come on them. You don't know where it came from or where it's going afterward, but you know you can hear the sound when they get the Holy Ghost. There is a sound that you can hear when somebody is born of the Spirit. Hallelujah. So is everyone. Say everyone. Everyone that's born of the Spirit. You won't see it come on them, but you'll hear the sound of it. Acts 2, 1 through 4. And when the day of Pentecost, 1 through 5 rather, we've already read it once. We're going to read again. Acts chapter number 2. If you got a Bible, go there. We're going to be there for a little while. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. We're in verse 2, Acts 2 and 2. As of a rushing mighty wind, it filled all the house where they were sitting. Acts 2 and 3. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire. It sat upon each of them. Verse 4. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. All of them were filled with the Holy Ghost. The Bible said in Acts, in John 3, so is everyone that's born of the Spirit. You can hear a sound of it. In Acts 2, they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And they were dwelling at Jerusalem, Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. There was a sound, and the sound was they were speaking in other tongues. Now let's look at verse number 6. Look, I like doctrinal preaching. I like doctrinal teaching. I like doctrine. I like the truth. I want somebody to give me something that's not true. I don't want a doctor to tell me. If I got a problem, I don't want a doctor to tell me something to make me feel better. I want him to do something to make me feel better. I don't want a preacher just to pat me on the back and say everything's okay. Tell me what the Bible says. Tell me what the truth is. It may hurt when I hear it, but if it'll help me get better, that's what I want. Give me the truth. Give me what the Bible says. Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Now when this was noised abroad, they got talking all over town. the people got to hearing about what was happening in that upper room. All those crazy people speaking in tongues and praising God. So people from all over the world, every nation under heaven came. And they when this was noise abroad, the multitude came together. And they come together to see what's happening. And the Bible said they were confounded. Everybody say confounded. They didn't understand. They didn't know what was going on. They didn't have a clue what was happening. All they see is the crazy people speaking in tongues. And what confounded them? What confused them? What was it that made them confounded? They don't say anything about the wind. That would have been my question. Where's that sound of the wind coming from? And it would have been about the fire. Where'd that fire come from? That would have been my two questions. Maybe it's because I've been raised in Pentecost all my life. But that wasn't their question. They weren't confused about the wind or the fire. They weren't confused about the worship. They were confused about one thing and one thing only. They were confused. What was it? And they were confounded because that every man heard them speak in his own language. They were confounded by speaking in tongues. Tongue talking confused the multitude. It still confuses the multitude. Acts 2 and 7. And they were all amazed. Everybody say they were amazed. And marveled. Come on. And marveled. Saying one to another. Are not all these which speak Galileans? What were they amazed and marveling at? Not a trick question. At what they were speaking. They were amazed and marveled at what they were speaking. So in verse 6, they were confounded over tongue talking. In verse 6, it was they were confounded over tongue talking. In verse number 7, they're amazed and marveling about tongue talking. In verse number 8, how hear we every man in our tongue wherein we were born? They have a question. What is all, how are we hearing tongue talking? What is this all about? Their question was about tongue talking. In verse number 11 of same chapter, Cretans and Arabians, we do hear them speak. Everybody say they spoke in our tongues the wonderful works of God. In verse number 12, and they were all amazed. Everybody say they were amazed. They were amazed by tongue talking. And they were in doubt. They were doubtful about tongue talking. You got people in this world that are amazed by it. You got people that doubt it. But that's no different than it was on the first day it was poured out. They were all amazed and were in doubt, saying one to another, what meaneth this? What does this mean? I got a question for you. What's that question about? Speaking in tongues. What does this mean? Repeatedly, in 6, in 7, in 8, in 11, in 12, they were asking, 5 times they asked about the Holy Ghost, about tongue talking. 5 times they mentioned tongue talking as what they were marveled about, amazed about, in doubt about, confounded about. And they said, what does this mean? The question specifically is, what is this tongue talking? What's this tongue talking mean? What is all this tongue talking going on? What meaneth this? Others mocking said, these men are full of new wine. Brother Dean Livingston one time said he had a denominational preacher say, he said, well, we were in the Acts chapter number 2. And he said, you were? He said, yeah, we were there. He said, well, were you talking in tongues and worshiping God? He said, no. He said, you were there? And he said, yeah, we were there. He went and had breakfast with him a few days later. He said, hey, I found you in the book of Acts chapter number 2. He said, you did? He said, yeah. It said, others mocking. Well, my life as a comedian, my career is going to be short. They were all amazed and were in doubt, saying one to another, what meaneth this? Others mocking said, these men are full of new wine. So the apostle stands up and says, these men are not drunken as ye suppose, seeing it's but the third hour of the day. It's not late enough in the day for them to be drunk yet. Now, Brother Barry, go to verse number 12 and tell me shout out the last 3 words. What meaneth this? And then the apostle Peter answers the specific question with a specific answer. this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. The question was, what does this tongue talking mean? What is all this tongue talking about? What is going on with all this tongue talking? And the apostle Peter stands out with the other apostles behind him and says, this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. He said, what you're hearing right now is the fulfillment of the promise that Joel prophesied all the way back in Joel chapter number 2, when Joel said that it shall come to pass afterward that I'll pour out my spirit. He said, what you are experiencing, what you're seeing is the same promise that Joel spoke about. Verse 17, it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my spirit on all flesh. He said, this is that. This tongue talking is that Holy Ghost experience. This tongue talking, oh God, I wish I had somebody said amen. This tongue talking is that spirit that God poured out on all flesh. It's not the spirit without tongue talking. Because this is that. It can't be this if it doesn't have that with it. You can't separate this and that, because this is that. Well, glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. You can't separate water and wetness. If it's water, it's wet. If it's wet, it's water. Praise God. You can't separate it. Well, you can't separate this and that. It can't be that without this, and it can't be this without that, because this is that, and this tongue talking is that Holy Ghost. Praise God. Hallelujah. I know that's a lot of this, that, and confusing, but I'm just telling you that when you get the Holy Ghost, you'll get that with it, because this is that. Amen. When you get the Holy Ghost, God will pour tongues. You don't have to seek for tongues. Seek for the Holy Ghost. Tongues will come with it. Don't worry about talking in tongues. Worry about God. And when you get the Holy Ghost, this will come with that. Well, glory to God. It's the Holy Ghost and fire, and it's keeping me alive. I've got it. I've got it. There's something about the power of the Holy Ghost. I can't explain it, but I've got it. This is that. This is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. Amen. I got my eye on the clock. Don't worry. Amen. Hallelujah. Acts 8:14. Now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received, everybody say they received. They received the word of God. Samaria received the word of God. They believed. Everybody say they believed. They believed on the word. They believed it so much they sent unto them that the apostles sent Peter and John to them, who when they were come down, prayed for them. Why did he pray for believers? That they might receive the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. This is important, folks, because some people are taught that the moment they believe, the Spirit comes on them. But that's not what the Bible said. Verse 16 of Acts 8, for as yet he was fallen upon none of them. But wait, they had received the word. They had received the word. They had received the message of Jesus. They were believers. But the Bible said, they, even though they had received the word, that the Holy Ghost had not fallen upon them yet. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them. Only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. You mean when I get baptized, I don't automatically get the Holy Ghost? No, you don't. I'm sorry, you don't. I didn't say it. The Bible said it. So they received the word and they were baptized, but they still didn't have the Holy Ghost. Are you kidding me? No, I'm not kidding you. That's what the Bible said, that they prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost, for as yet he was fallen upon none of them. Only they were baptized in the name of the Lord. Then laid they their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. You don't automatically get the Holy Ghost when you repent, when you believe, or when you're baptized. You have to have a baptism, a birth of the Spirit. It's truth. It's the truth. It's the Bible. Isaiah 28, 11 and 12, for with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to this people to whom he said, this is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest. And this is the refreshing. Let's go quickly. I got about 9 minutes. I'm going to get it in while I can. Acts 10, 1 and 2. There was a certain man in Caesarea named Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian band, a devout man. Everybody say he was devoted. One that feared God. Everybody say he feared God with all of his house, which gave much alms. He was a giver. Everybody say he was a giver. And prayed to God always. He was a praying man. Boy, that sounds like a good fella, don't it? It sounds like a good man, doesn't it? But being good doesn't get you to heaven. You got to be born again. He was a devout man. He feared God. He gave alms. And he prayed to God always. But he still wasn't saved. I'll prove that to you in a minute. Cornelius was devoted. It means he was reverent. He was pious and godly. He feared God. It meant one who was acquainted with true God, who understood the word and the laws. He was abundantly clear that Cornelius was a man of impeccable character and obvious faith in God. But yet, he was not saved. Verse number 3. He saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming in unto him and saying unto him, Cornelius. God spoke his name. And when he looked on him, he was afraid and said, what is it, Lord? And he said unto him, thy prayers and thine alms are come up for a memorial before God. He said, I see all that praying you're doing. I see all that giving. Look, if you want God to see you, pray and give. Because God sees people that pray and give. Amen. That's another message for another night. And now send men to Joppa. He said, you got to send men to Joppa. Call for one Simon whose surname is Peter. Why did he have to go get Peter? Because Peter was the one that got the keys of the kingdom. You remember that? Jesus said, who do men say that I am? Well, some say Jeremiah, some say one of the prophets. He said, who do you say that I am? Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. He said, upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail it. And he said to Peter, I give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. He said, you've got the keys of every door of the kingdom. If the door is going to be open, you're going to be the one to open it. Peter had the keys of the kingdom. So in Acts chapter number 2, when people said, tell us what we got to do, who was it that stood up? It was the man with the keys. He went and opened the door. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. He opened the door for the Jews to get in. Now in Acts chapter number 10, he's opening the door for the Gentiles. He said, you got to go get the man with the keys. If you're going to get saved, get the man with the keys. Look, don't ask somebody who don't have the Holy Ghost how to be saved. Ask somebody that's been baptized with the Spirit. Amen. Don't believe some denomination. To go to the Word of God and believe what the Bible said. Don't believe what some denomination or some synod or some conference says. Get somebody that'll open the Word of God and say, here's what the Bible says about it. He said, get a man with the keys of the kingdom in his hand. So they went for Simon. My God, I love preaching doctrine. Good Lord, have mercy. Oh God. Oh Lord, I wish people liked hearing it as much as I like preaching it. Amen. He said, go get Simon, whose surname is Peter, because that's the man that has the keys of the kingdom. He lodges one Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the seaside. He shall tell thee what thou oughtest to do. Well, if he's going to tell me what I ought to do, it means I ought to, but I don't have to. Know the word oughtest in the Greek. It means it is necessary. There is need of. It behooves. It's right. It's proper. A necessity of law. A necessity of command. A necessity of duty. A necessity of equity. Necessity established by the counsel and decree of God, especially by the purpose of that which relates to salvation. Everybody say salvation. He'll tell you what you got to do to be saved. Cornelius' messengers were explaining to the Apostle Peter why he was sent for, Acts 10 and 22. And they said, Cornelius, the centurion, a just man, one that feareth God, and of good report among all the nation of the Jews, was warned from God by a holy angel. Look, you only get warnings when you're in danger. You don't get warnings when everything's all right. You get warnings when you're in danger. He said Cornelius was praying and God warned him. He has to go get Simon Peter. He warned Cornelius, even though he was a devout man, even though he was a just man, even though he gave alms, even though he prayed always, even though he feared God with all of his house, he was in danger because he had to be born again, because being good isn't good enough. You must be born again. He said he was warned. Cornelius, you're a good man, but you got to get born again. Cornelius, you give, but you got to be born again. Cornelius, you pray, but you got to be born again. He was warned of God by a holy angel to send for thee. So hear words of thee. People got to hear the word, folks. We got to preach the word. I'm going to throw this in, and you're doing a great job this morning. I appreciate it. And you've done a great job. But I've told you this before. I hope we can get spiritually mature enough that I can preach Acts 2:38 every Sunday. And you'll still shout like it's the first time you heard it, because everybody deserves to hear and experience the gospel of Jesus Christ. I hope we never get tired of it, folks. I hope we never get tired of hearing doctrinal preaching, because fluff won't get you to heaven. We got to be built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself, the chief cornerstone. Amen. Was warned of God by a holy angel. He's going to hear words of thee. Verse 45. And I'm skipping a bunch of stuff. But the Bible said that while Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all them which heard the word. The Holy Ghost fell. While Peter preached the word, the Holy Ghost fell on them. I believe the Holy Ghost, we ought to let the Holy Ghost fall on us while the preaching's happening. Amen. While the truth is being preached, we ought to just let the Holy Ghost fall on us. And while Peter yet spake these words, verse 44, the Holy Ghost fell on all them which heard the word. In verse 45, they of the circumcision, that is a word that referred directly to the Jewish people. It was their rite of circumcision. It was their custom. And they of the circumcision, which believed, were astonished. They were amazed. They were absolutely blown away. As many as came with Peter, because see, they didn't think anybody but Jews could be saved. They didn't think anybody but them could be saved. It was only for God's chosen people. It was only for the Jews. They of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter. Why were they astonished? Why were they amazed? What was it that got their attention? Because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. These Jews thought they were the only ones that could be saved. And they say, these people got the Holy Ghost? These Gentiles, this Cornelius, this Italian Gentile Cornelius got the Holy Ghost? My question is, how did they know? If he got it when you repent, how'd they know he got the Holy Ghost? Verse 46, for they heard them. The wind bloweth where it listeth. You know where it's coming from or where it's going. But you can hear the sound thereof. And so is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Oh, hallelujah. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that these should be baptized who have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? They got the Holy Ghost just like we did, speaking in tongues. For they heard them. The Living Bible says, but there, listen to the, oh, this is awesome. The Living Bible of Acts 10:46, but there could be no doubt about it. Look at somebody say, no doubt about it. Look at somebody else, tell them there's no doubt about it. You don't have to hope you got it. You don't have to wish you got it. You don't have to hope that preacher's telling you the truth. There was no doubt. There could be no doubt about it. Shout it out. Say, there's no doubt. There could be no doubt about it, for they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Whew. Oh, Lord, I got 1 minute. It ignited a controversy among the Jewish Christian church in Jerusalem because the Gentiles had received the Holy Ghost. Here was Peter's explanation to them in Acts 11:13-18. And he showed us how he had seen an angel in his house, which stood and said unto him, send men to Joppa and call for Simon, whose surname is Peter. He'll tell you words whereby thou and all thy house shall be saved. Cornelius wasn't saved yet until he was born of the Spirit and baptized in Jesus' name. He wasn't saved yet. He was a good man. He was a devoted man. He was a giving man. He was a praying man, but he wasn't a saved man. God help us. God help us to understand the Bible. God help us to get the word in us. He's going to tell you words whereby you can be saved. Why would a devoted, praying, giving man need to be saved? Because you got to be born of the water and of the Spirit, or you can't enter into the kingdom of God. He said he'll tell you words whereby you and your house can be saved. And as I began to speak, the Holy Ghost fell on them, as on us in the beginning. How did it fall on Cornelius? They heard him speak with tongues. He said it happened on them just like it did on us in the beginning. It's the same baptism that we got in the upper room. He said it's the same thing that we got. Then I remember the word of the Lord saying, how? That he said, John indeed baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. And then he looked at all those Jews who were skeptical, and he said, for as much then as God gave them the like gift as he did unto us who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, what was I that I could withstand God? And when they heard these things, they held their peace and glorified God, saying, then hath God also to the Gentiles granted repentance unto life. Stand with me. I'm closing this doctrinal message. If you'll give me about 2 more minutes, I got one more passage. Acts 19, it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus, and finding certain disciples, say he found disciples. Come on, say he found disciples. He found believers. He found believers. He found people that believed in Jesus. And he said to them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Look, this is proof positive that you don't automatically get the Holy Ghost when you believed. If you automatically got it, Paul would have said, good thing you got the Holy Ghost when you believed. But he didn't say that. He said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Even though you're a believer, you need to get the Holy Ghost, folks. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And they said unto him, we've not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. You don't have that excuse today, folks. We've taken that out of the books. You can get the Holy Ghost. The promise is unto you. Everybody under the sound of my voice, you have the promise of the Holy Ghost. God wants to fill you with the Spirit. You wouldn't be here if he didn't want you to have the Holy Ghost. You wouldn't have heard this message if he didn't want you to have the Holy Ghost. The promise. Have you received? We've not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. And he said to them, unto what then were you baptized? And they said, unto John's baptism. It matters how you're baptized. Can I get an amen? It matters how you're baptized. Then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is on Christ Jesus. If believing and repenting were enough, they wouldn't have to go on. But he went on. And when they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Everybody in this place has not been baptized when the preacher said, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You need to be rebaptized in Jesus' name today. You need to be rebaptized when the preacher says, I baptize you in the name of Jesus Christ. They rebaptized them there. And when they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. I preach about the Holy Ghost today. Amen. I'm glad I got the Holy Ghost. I'm glad somebody told me I could have it. And I'm going to tell you, I'm telling you today, everybody under the sound of my voice, the greatest thing that will ever happen to you. It's better than any. Look, somebody was talking about this $900 million lottery that was going on out in Nevada. $900 million. And nobody won it. And the next week, it's going to be $1.3 billion in a lottery. And whoever wins that, if they don't die of a heart attack, when they scratch it off or whatever they do, when the number's called or whatever happens, and it goes one by one, and the first number hits, and the second number hits, and the third, and on down, however many numbers there is, and that last one comes up, their number, and they realize they have instantly become a billionaire until the government takes theirs out. And that overwhelming rush of emotion where they realize that my not only my life, but generations after me are set up from now till kingdom come. And that wash of euphoria hits them. It's nothing like the Holy Ghost. Woo, glory to God. Hallelujah. I heard a story last night about a man who worked his whole life and made a bunch of money, and then he was dying. And he told his wife, he said, When I die, I want you to put every dime I got in my casket with me. And his wife said, well, you can't take it, you can't use it. He said, I don't care, I work for it, I want it, nobody else is getting it. You put it in my casket. Because I'm taking it with me. Nobody else is getting my money. I worked my whole life for it, nobody else is getting it. So they had the funeral and they had the casket open, they had to get ready to leave. And right when they were closing the service, the wife said, whoa, wait a minute. She got out the checkbook and wrote a check. And said, honey, here's every dime you ever made. Put the check in the casket and closed the lid and walked away. Because you can't take it with you. You can't take your billions with you. You can't take your dimes with you. You can't take your cars. You can't take anything with you. The only thing you're going to have when you get out of here is the spirit of him that raised up Christ from the dead. If it dwell in you, the greatest gift you can ever have is the Holy Ghost. The best thing in the world is the Holy Ghost. The greatest day of my life was the day I got the Holy Ghost. Hey, it's the Holy Ghost and fire. My God, I'm glad I got it. It still makes me want to shout. It still makes me want to praise him. It still makes me want to raise my hands. Because it's the best thing that ever happened to me. If I didn't have to have it, I'd still want it. If I didn't need it, I'd still want it. If I didn't have to go to heaven, I'd still want it. Because it's the best thing. Oh God, I wish somebody's got it would praise him. It's the Holy Ghost and fire. Sing it in one second. But let me tell you, if you need the Holy Ghost, don't sit here and worry all about talking in tongues and now I'm going to speak in tongues. Look, here's what you do. You worship God before you get the Holy Ghost, right, like you would if you got the Holy Ghost. And you just worship and praise God and love God. And I'm going to tell you, the Holy Ghost will come. And when the Holy Ghost comes, tongues will come. And the Holy Ghost will fill you with the joy of the Lord. Just worship God and praise God and don't get stressed out. The Holy Ghost is joy. The Holy Ghost is peace. The Holy Ghost is good. Don't worry, but just praise God and let the Holy Ghost fall. And if you got the Holy Ghost before, you ought to just praise God one more time. Everybody in this place ought to get another baptism of the Holy Ghost today. You ought to talk in tongues one more time. You ought to shout one more time. You ought to praise him one more time.
I wish somebody so would catch on fire. Catch on fire. Catch on fire.
Somebody's soul, catch on fire, burning with the Holy Ghost. church and glad to have the Holy Ghost this morning. Praise God. It's not a question if I've got it. I know I got it. Praise God, I can take you to the spot. And then I don't settle for that. I try to get it every chance I can. Praise God. I don't want to get there one day and God say, you ain't got it. You didn't get it. You know, I had a friend one time at work. And we had to have a certain license to continue to work. And they kept telling us, you got to get this license if you want to keep on working. You got to get this license. And it kept going on and on. And everybody got it except this one friend of mine. And he just swore them down. He said, they're not going to do anything. I've been here long enough. And it got to the cutoff date, and he didn't have that license. And they had no choice, but they had to let him go. You know what? I'd hate to get to heaven. I'd hate to get to heaven. And God said, I cannot let you in. Right. And I put it in my word. I sent a pastor to preach it to you on a Sunday morning, January 10, 2016. But you still wouldn't listen. You're not getting in. I'm thankful to God that I got the Holy Ghost. Amen. I'm thankful that there's no question, there's no doubt in my mind. I don't need somebody to tell me. I know I got it. And I'm thankful today that God has given me His Spirit. It's a gift. And it's promised unto you. Can we give the Lord a hand clap today? Thankful for our pastor that preached this word to us today. Thankful for the Spirit of God, seeing you worship the Lord like you have today. And there's just no telling what God has in store for us. We stay in this. Just remember tonight, I think Pastor wanted to meet with everybody on the platform. Did he say 5 o'clock? 5 o'clock. Just remember that. And also come early for prayer at 6 o'clock. Be ready in the Lord for an outpouring of the Holy Ghost tonight, right? We know about it today, so we're ready for it tonight. Amen? Praise God. You're dismissed today. Bring your tithe, unto the Lord this morning. In Jesus' name.